Thank you. We will now continue with this afternoon's business. And the first, this afternoon's business is the next item of business, portfolio questions. The first portfolio is Deputy First Minister Responsibilities, Economy and Gaelic. And at question number one, I call Evelyn Tweed.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the findings from Santander on the impact of Brexit on UK-EU trade as it relates to Scotland's economy.
Deputy First Minister Kate Forbes.
Well, there is now considerable evidence available demonstrating the damaging impact of Brexit. Recently, researchers from Aston University estimated that exports of goods to the EU were 17% lower and imports of goods were 23% lower in 2023. And according to analysis by the National Institute of Social and Economic Research, the UK economy was 2.5% smaller in 2023, all of which is attributed to Brexit. In Scotland, despite our unequivocal vote in the referendum to remain in the EU, we are not being spared the effects or the costs to the Scottish economy.
Evelyn Tweed.
As well as lost trade, Brexit has led to staffing shortages in many sectors across our economy. What measures are available to the Scottish Government to reduce the barriers for business to attract EU workers to fill vital roles?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, the member is right to highlight the particular impact on staffing shortages. EU citizens who moved to Scotland, who made a significant contribution to our economy, have in many cases returned back to their home countries, and it's deeply disappointing that the migration system is not currently meeting Scotland's ongoing distinct demographic needs. So we've been clear that changes to the system to support employers and individuals are vital. We need a migration route that's tailored to Scotland's needs, particularly through a Scottish visa or a rural visa pilot. And those are both proposals on the table that we hope the UK Government will take seriously.
Question number two, Jeremy Balfour.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether the participation of disabled people in the economy is of a significant benefit.
Minister Tom Arthur.
President Officer, please accept my apology and extend my apologies to members of the Chamber for my failure to be present at the opening of questions. I had misunderstood when the session would be reconvening. The participation of disabled people in the economy is an important factor in individuals' ability to thrive and live fulfilling lives, and growing the economy is one of the Government's top four priorities. The programme for Government sets out how we will support people already in work, help more people back into work and address long-term economic inactivity. Alongside our national employability offer, this includes improving access to health services by 2025 and introducing enhanced specialist support for disabled people across all 32 local authorities.
Jeremy Balfour.
Can I thank the Minister for his answer? Disabled people make up around 20% of the population in Scotland. However, many of them remain unable to participate in society due to historic and systematic barriers that still exist. Does the Minister agree with me that we deserve a champion in the shape of a Disability Commissioner to ensure that the future is brighter than the past?
Minister.
Well, can I recognise the substance of the member's question and his championing of the issue of a commissioner. I appreciate this is something Parliament will consider in more detail, more broadly on the commissioner landscape. What I do want to provide reassurance to the member on is this government's commitment on closing the disability employment gap, and that we are committed to doing that not only in partnership with local government, but indeed in partnership with the UK Government, who are taking forward an agenda. And given the significant importance that reserved areas play on the employability landscape, so I am committed to working in a genuine spirit of partnership to ensure that we close a disability employment gap so we can have a Scotland where everyone who wishes to can fully participate within the labour market.
Supplementary, Emma Ruddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Anyone who wants to secure and sustain work should be able to do so, regardless of disability. Can the Minister provide an update on the Scottish Government's ambition to ensure that people seeking work who are disabled or have long-term health conditions are offered support from a dedicated employability advisor, as outlined in the programme for Government?
Minister.
Thank you. For our No One Left Behind approach to devolved employability services, disabled people are currently eligible for support from a dedicated advisor in all 32 local authorities. Our statistics show we are making progress here, with the proportion of disabled people accessing our services increasing. However, we are committed to doing more to tackle labour market inequality, which is why we have committed to introduce specialist employability support from summer 2025 in the programme for Government. This will ensure greater levels of support locally for disabled people to select, obtain and retain employment.
Question number three, Daniel Johnson.
To ask the Scottish Government how it evaluates the performance of the enterprise agencies in directly investing in businesses.
Minister Richard Lochhead.
Our enterprise agencies have a critical role in helping businesses to start and scale, be more productive, access finance and attract investment, and develop new products and services, enter new markets and positively impact on communities. The agencies evaluate the support they provide to businesses in order to assess the effectiveness and impact of their activity. They report on their performance throughout the year and publish their results in their annual reports and accounts. Scottish Enterprise also monitors investment activity in Scotland and publishes an annual overview of trends and performance.
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the Minister for that answer. And according to those published numbers, Scottish Enterprise invested just 15% of its budget in 23-24. That's some £53.4 million, as against the South of Scotland Enterprise Agency, which invested 55% of its budget, some £35 million, and Highlands and Islands Enterprise, 72%, £63 million, despite very different levels of funding. Now, given that in real terms, Enterprise Agency funding has fallen by £46 million in real terms since 2016, what steps will the government take to ensure that it maximises its outcomes and impact and investment undertaken by the enterprise agencies?
Minister.
Well, each of the enterprise companies takes its own decisions in line with its own priorities for its region. And Scottish Enterprise's co-investment and Scottish venture funds have been highly successful, with £158 million invested in 229 companies between mid-2015 and spring 2020, for instance. That investment averaged almost £500 million from the private sector, achieving a 3-to-1 ratio. And over the last 21 years, Scottish Enterprise invested £921 million, which has leveraged £2.45 billion of private sector investment. So clearly Scottish Enterprise is of a different scale to the other enterprise companies in some ways and deals with different issues, and as is Highlands and Islands Enterprise, has its own remit and so on and so forth. So I think the Scottish Government is very content with the results of Scottish Enterprise's co-investment.
Supplementary, Audrey Nicol.
Thank you. Scottish Enterprise has delivered its strongest ever performance on jobs and capital investment over a record year. But can the Minister say any more about how we can build on this strong track record and continue to support businesses and drive innovation?
Minister.
Well, the ambition within the current action plan that is being developed by industry is to better tailor existing and new support to specific requirements from the sector to grow Scotland's ambitious ecosystem, and that includes strategies in relation to the National Strategy for Economic Transformation and so on. So there's a number of policies in place to build upon existing innovation and successes.
Supplementary, Pam Gozo.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Young Enterprise Scotland plays an important role in offering enterprise education to schools and has done for more than 30 years. It was recently reported that the organisation was at risk of closure as the Scottish Government had initially decided to discontinue funding. While I was pleased to hear that funding had eventually been allocated by the Scottish Government, institutions such as this, one should not have to wait for last-minute solutions. Therefore, can I ask the Minister what action the Scottish Government is taking to ensure that such organisations are properly funded so that pupils receive education on enterprise?
Minister.
Well, as the member will be aware, and as indeed she referred to, the Deputy First Minister announced yesterday £285,000 for Young Enterprise Scotland, who are doing a grand job, and the funding was never withdrawn. The discussions were ongoing. So the Scottish Government very much values the work of Young Enterprise Scotland, and that is evidenced by yesterday's support that was delivered for them.
Question number four, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting entrepreneurship in Scotland's games sector.
Minister.
Did you see me?
Sorry, Minister. Richard Lochhead.
The Scottish Government is committed to supporting entrepreneurs across all sectors, including our vibrant games industry, which contributes significantly to Scotland's economy and culture. We're delivering support through our key entrepreneurial strategies, including initiatives like TechScaler and the Ecosystem Fund. We've funded Scottish Games Week for two consecutive years and are considering games as a priority sector in our international TechScaler strategy. Following ministers' meeting with industry figures in recent months, we're also working with the sector to develop an action plan and a strategy to better target support for the Scottish games ecosystem.
Claire Adamson.
I thank the Minister for his answer. There isn't a specific mention of game sectors within some of the strategies, although they do mention data, cyber, fintech, AI in other areas. And I would like to know how we can actually enhance the game sector, which contributes £180 million GVA to the Scottish economy, which performs well in UK terms as well, but compared to almost £2 billion generated in Finland, where they're an integral part of the country's tech funding. And I wonder if the Minister has any ideas on how we can improve the performance even more in Scotland.
Minister.
Claire Adamson quite rightly highlights the massive potential of the game sector in Scotland, and that's why we're very keen to hear the outcome of the current work by the industry on what a strategy should look like for the future of the sector in Scotland. There's a lot of cross-pollination between the game sector and other high-tech sectors in Scotland. I think we should do more to recognise that and support that, which could lead to more potential being realised within the sector as well. And of course, when you think of Grand Theft Auto, I think it's about to announce its new edition in the coming months, which is expected to be the fastest-selling game of all time at that time. I'm reading in the tech press, and we should celebrate that as a country, because that's a game which, of course, is one of many famous games born in Scotland.
A supplementary, Michael Barra.
Thank the Minister for that answer. I mean, certainly the Grand Theft Auto, born in my home city of Dundee, and we should be proud of that. It's part of the biggest entertainment industry in the world now, gaming. And Scotland has a really good footprint in that area, but much more can be done. What would the Cabinet Secretary say about reflecting on the success, the particular success of Screen Scotland as a model for supporting part of those sectors? What can we learn from that policy success that can be translated into the games industry?
Minister.
Well, clearly, as I indicated in my previous answer, the industry do feel that many of the wider benefits of the game sector in Scotland are not recognised to the degree they should be, and that's why we've given a commitment to support them in the development of a strategy for the future of the sector. So whether we learn from Screen Scotland or other policies affecting other sectors is something, of course, we should look at, and I agree with that. But clearly, we have many high-growth tech sectors in Scotland at the moment, and the game sector and the technologies developed within the game sector are very central to these other technologies as well. And I think that's why we need more joined-up thinking in Scotland, and the game sector are very keen to be at the heart of that thinking, not just siloed into a game sector. So I think that's an important way forward.
Question number five, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to sustain the economic value of the chemical production sector based around Grangemouth.
Deputy First Minister Kate Forbeson.
Well, we are committed to securing a long-term and sustainable future for the Grangemouth cluster. We'll shortly publish our draft Grangemouth Just Transition Plan, which details the shared vision for the future of the cluster as Scotland's premier location for investment in advanced chemical manufacturing. And as part of the plan, which has been developed in collaboration with the Grangemouth Future Industry Board, representatives from the chemicals manufacturing sector are supporting the development of a cluster strategy which is aimed at attracting new investment. And that work will be supported by the Fourth Green Freeport and the Falkirk and Grangemouth growth deal.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. The threat to the refinery is equally a threat to the chemical cluster and a threat to Scotland's economy. Given the recent Scottish Enterprise investment to INEOS for the Green Freeports initiative, what further incentives might be provided through Fourth Green Freeports or indeed directly to the cluster to maximise long-term financial sustainability and enable growth as outlined in the Green Industrial Strategy?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, the member makes an important point. I believe that the Scottish Enterprise funding that she is referencing is not actually part of the Green Freeport programme, but is part of the Scottish Enterprise funding looking at the potential for hydrogen generation at the site, because Grangemouth has the potential to be a significant part of Scotland's low-carbon transition, and that's why we've confirmed £50 million through the growth deal, as well as jointly funding the £1.5 million Project Willow study, which was discussed again yesterday in my regular meeting with the Secretary of State for Scotland. There are a range of specific interventions and supports available.
Question number six, Richard Leonard.
Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I remind members of my voluntary register of trade union interests to ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the potential closure of the Grangemouth oil refinery and any economic impact that this may have?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, as the member will know, Petro-Ineos announced on the 12th of September that refining would cease during the second quarter of next year. It's a commercial decision taken by the business alone and taken despite the joint efforts of the Scottish and UK governments to secure those investments in the asset beyond 2025. It's our understanding that the immediate impact of that decision will be the loss of around 400 full-time roles. We are all jointly, as governments, committed to doing all that we can to support the workforce during the transition period. That's why we announced the Forth Valley College provision of tailored skills, supported by both governments, targeted towards those directly impacted by the decision.
Richard Leonard.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that reply? But she must know that the rate of unemployment in Grangemouth is already twice the national average, that this is a community already impoverished. The statutory redundancy consultation closes in mid-December, so the clock is ticking, but there is still time to save these jobs. So in the coming days, will the Cabinet Secretary for Economy, together with the First Minister, intervene, just as I call on the UK Labour government to intervene, to avert these redundancies, to extend the life of Scotland's only oil refinery, and do so in the interests not only of these workers and their families, not only of this community, but in the strategic interests of our country's economy, energy security, and national security.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister.
Well, the member makes an important point about the impact on the local economy of the loss of these jobs, and it's precisely why, for the last few years, the Scottish Government has been doing everything within its power to save the jobs and to save refining at Grangemouth. We are still working when it comes to supporting those individuals at risk of redundancy through the skills package that I already talked about in my opening answer. And the funding that we have put in place will allow Petro-Ineos employees at Grangemouth access the opportunity to reskill, and we will support them also in terms of new employment. But can I also just say, in terms of the long-term future for the site, that is precisely why we're involved with Project Willow. We have spent considerable sums of money over the last few years looking for a long-term future for Petro-Ineos. This is a commercial decision. I think we are all jointly keen to ensure that there is a future for those workers.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister.
And we're working jointly
to do that.
I'll
take a brief supplementary, David Torrens.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is vital that we continue to support the workers based at Grangemouth and their families during this difficult time. And I welcome the additional funding the Scottish Government has provided through the Falkirk and Grangemouth growth deal. Can the Cabinet Secretary say more about how this will help grow the regional economy and support the community and workers?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, that £50 million through the Falkirk and Grangemouth growth deal over the next 10 years is designed to unlock economic growth opportunities, which create the jobs that ensures that unemployment is low, employment rates are high, and indeed we don't lose sight of economic inactivity as well. And our investments in that deal include £2 million towards the sustainable manufacturing campus to allow the development of new technologies in the region, £12 million on the Greener Grangemouth programme, and the wider growth deal is expected to bring significant benefits over the coming year, generating £628 million over the next 30 years.
Question number 7, Bob Doris.
Apologies, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Economy Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding how its approach to business taxation supports the economy.
Minister Tom Arthur.
Ministers meet regularly to ensure the economy is prioritised and work underway across government. Our views informed through extensive stakeholder engagements with the business community, think tanks, civic society, tax professionals and local government.
Bob Doris.
Okay, I thank the Minister for that answer. One aspect of business taxation that I have previously supported and suggested could be revisited is the large retailer supplement, which is reported to have raised £95 million from 2012 to 2015. Given that the Fraser Andrews Institute has previously suggested that retailers make an excess profit of £30 million a year due to minimum pricing, what assessment has the Scottish Government made of the economic impact and budgetary benefit of a future large retailer levy for large retailers selling alcohol?
Minister.
The Scottish Budget 2024-25 signalled an intention to explore the reintroduction of a non-domestic rates public health supplement for large retailers in advance of the next budget. The Scottish Government has engaged with relevant stakeholders, including public health organisations and retailers, to explore the potential effects the reintroduction of a public health supplement may have. We are committed to consulting with the New Deal for Business group on this policy. This will ensure considered and informed decisions can be made in the context of the Scottish Budget 2025-26.
Supplementary, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The UK Chancellor has just announced a hike in employers' national insurance to 15%, which will hammer businesses across Scotland. But the same budget delivers substantial Barnett consequentials to the Scottish finances. So, as we know, we haven't seen passed on in the last 2 years the 75% rates relief to retail, hospitality and leisure businesses in Scotland. Given that the Scottish budget may well be enhanced, isn't it time now to look at supporting our businesses with lower taxes rather than doing what Mr Bob Doris suggests and hitting them with even further increases?
Minister.
Well, as the member will be aware, there is non-domestic rates reliefs totalling some £685 million this year. He'll appreciate the budget has just been delivered. Decisions about next year's taxation regime will be set out by the Finance Secretary at the budget. And we, of course, rather like the bond market and everyone else, digesting the UK Government budget currently.
Question number 8, Graeme Simpson.
To ask the Scottish Government what progress has been made towards securing a long-term future for Ferguson Marine.
Deputy First Minister.
Well, we've been working closely with the board of Ferguson Marine to look at the options for a sustainable future. The member will know about our willingness to provide substantial new funding to modernise the yard, to enhance productivity and strengthen its ability to compete for new business.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the Deputy First Minister for that answer? She'll be aware that Ferguson Marine is in the running for the Small Vessels Replacement Programme, which is good news. But what happens if the yard doesn't win any of that work? Is there a plan B? Are they in line for any other contracts? And what is the plan to return it to the private sector?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, I'm glad I was sitting down when Graeme Simpson said something was good news. And I share his optimism on that point. I think we're all pleased to see progress in the procurement process for 7 new small vessels. And as he said, Ferguson Marine is one of the 6 shipbuilders selected by CMAL, the procurement authority, to move to the next stage. He will know that as per procurement legislation and guidelines, I'm not involved in the review or the selection process, and I would be loath to be drawn into commenting further on a matter that he may come back and criticise me for. So we'll leave it at that, but we can agree that it is good news.
And brief supplementary, Stuart McMillan, who I believe is joining us remotely. Do we have a picture of Mr McMillan live?
Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Mr McMillan, could you put your camera on, please?
Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Mr McMillan, you don't have your camera on, and we do like to see people when they're speaking.
Okay.
Physically, live speaking. Thank you.
Sorry. Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I welcome the Scottish Government's work so far on saving the jobs at Ferguson Marine and its commitment to protecting these jobs going forward through the significant investment to help future-proof the site. But can the Deputy First Minister say any more about what she hopes to achieve from this investment and also the long-term benefit to the yard?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, the member will know that when I set out this additional investment, I did say it was always going to be subject to the completion of the necessary legal and commercial evaluations. But our hope is that that additional investment secures a long-term future for the yard by making it more competitive and more productive, which means it's able to compete when it comes to tenders for additional work, because ultimately that is the route by which Ferguson Marine has a long-term future, putting the brilliant skills and workforce to best use in the yard.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on Deputy First Minister responsibilities, economy and Gaelic. Apologies to those few members I was unable to take in terms of supplementaries, but we are very tight for time over the course of this afternoon itself, evidently. There will be a very short pause before we move on to the next portfolio. Thank you. Thank you. The next portfolio this afternoon is Finance and Local Government. And at question number one, I call Rhoda Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government how youth groups can access funds to buy community assets.
Minister Ivan McKee.
The Scottish Land Fund is a funding source for community groups who are looking to purchase assets in their community. It is open to all groups that are community-led, community-controlled and defined by a geographic area. This can include youth groups based within those communities. Any such group should contact the National Lottery Community Fund to administer the Scottish Land Fund on behalf of Scottish ministers, and they will be given guidance and assistance on how they can apply to the fund.
Rhoda Grant.
The 18th Inverness Muirton Scout Group wish to apply to Scottish Canals for an asset transfer for their Scout Hall. However, the legislation doesn't designate Scout Groups as community bodies eligible for asset transfer. Scottish ministers have the powers under the Act to designate organisations like that and make them eligible for transfer. Therefore, can I ask the Minister whether Scottish Government will designate Scout Groups as bodies eligible under the Act for asset transfer? Because their activities fall within the spirit of the Act. And, Presiding Officer, for transparency, I should say that my husband is a Scout leader with the 18th Muirton Group.
Minister.
As I said, the opportunity to purchase assets is open to all groups that are community-led, community-controlled and defined by a geographic area. And in the specific instance that she mentions, I'm happy to take that up separately with the member to explore what opportunities there are to make sure that the youth group is able to be part of this, the Scout group is able to be part of this, because, as I said, this can include youth groups based within those communities.
Question number two, Stephen Kerr.
To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has in place for local authorities that may be unable to fulfil any legal requirements for a balanced budget in the forthcoming financial year.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robertson.
Scottish ministers remain committed to working with local government to ensure the sustainability of local services. However, local authorities do have a statutory duty to set a balanced budget, and it is for locally elected representatives to decide how they do that.
Stephen Kerr.
Thank you. My question really was what are the plans in case that doesn't happen? So what will she do when a Scottish Council can't set a budget? Does she recognise the huge problems of health and social care overspends, wages bills, pensions, unfunded Scottish Government commitments? When will she come up with a long-term plan for local government in Scotland to stop it teetering from crisis to crisis?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm not sure if Stephen Kerr got the memo that the Scottish Tories are now reducing spend across public services. That was certainly the outline from the new leader, Russell Finlay. But we take our responsibilities to fund local government very seriously. That's why we have funded local government with £14 billion, which is a real terms increase, not just according to us, but according to the Accounts Commission, and indeed the SPICE within this Parliament have both said that is the case. That doesn't take away from the enormous pressures facing local government and other public services, which is why, as part of the budget, we will discuss with local government, as we are doing, to make sure that we can support them to reach a sustainable position going forward. And of course, yesterday I set out the Scottish Government's plan to deliver a sustainability delivery plan alongside MTFS in the spring.
And supplementary, Michael Marra.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In evidence to the Finance Committee on 1st of October, Council leaders and directors of finance warned us that they're already at breaking point with the delivery of statutory services under clear threat. Does the Cabinet Secretary not accept that it's her government's chaotic and incompetent approach to budgeting that has left Council services on their knees?
Cabinet Secretary.
No, I don't accept that, because the Accounts Commission and SPICE have both acknowledged and agreed with the Scottish Government that local government has received a real terms increase in funding, £14 billion, and indeed an increasing share of discretionary spend of the Scottish Government. So they've got, despite all of the financial challenges, local government has had a bigger share of the pot available. That's not to say I don't recognise some of the challenges that local government has, and that's why we are working very closely with COSLA and will continue to do so as we work towards the budget on the 4th of December.
Question number three, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to improve transparency in the management of Scotland's finance.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government is open and transparent on the Scottish Budget and the management of Scotland's finances. Through successive Open Government National Action Plans, we've worked with the Parliament, its committees and wider stakeholders to improve the understanding of our public finances, and 23 supporting documents were published for the Scottish Budget 24-25. We also intend to publish data and analysis on public body expenditure by the end of November.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. Parliament should be able to scrutinise the budget and ensure that Scottish Government spends taxpayers' money effectively. Instead, we have creative, selective or incomplete presentation of figures, keep budget documents going unpublished, and well-regarded voices, including Fraser of Allender Institute and Audit Scotland, all criticising the Government's failure on transparency. Can the Cabinet Secretary guarantee that all agreed information will be supplied to the Scottish Fiscal Commission ahead of the Scottish Budget? And will she use the 2025-26 budget to put an end to 17 years of creative accounting and financial slip of hands?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I don't accept that last characterisation at all. And in fact, for 17 years, we have delivered a balanced budget. And yet again, for this last year, we've had an unqualified set of audited opinions. So no qualification by the auditors for the Scottish Government's finances. And I think Faisal Chowdhury should reflect on that when he uses language like he did. In terms of the scrutinisation and transparency, I have agreed with the Finance Committee for this budget to attend additional sessions. We will make sure that there is information available, as we always do. And of course, I very much recognise the important role of the Scottish Fiscal Commission. We will provide the Scottish Fiscal Commission with the information they require to produce the reports, which I know are important for the scrutiny of this Parliament.
Question number four, David Torrens.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment has made on what Scotland's fiscal position would be today had the UK remained a member of the EU.
Cabinet Secretary.
Independent researchers have tracked the fiscal and economic impacts of Brexit since the referendum in 2016. According to analysis by the National Institute of Social and Economic Research, the UK economy was 2.5% smaller in 2023 due to Brexit, and this gap may widen to 5.7% by 2035. This equates to around £69 billion in output and £28 billion in public revenues lost in 2023. For Scotland, this is equivalent to a cut in public revenues of around £2.3 billion in 2023. The economic hole is a stark reminder of the price of Brexit.
David Torrens.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Given the overwhelming support to remain in the EU by Scottish voters in 2016, and noting the damage to Scotland's economy from years of continued Westminster austerity policies, would the Minister agree that it is now more important than ever for Scotland to have the powers to decide its own future?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, of course, I do agree with David Torrens on that point. And of course, the only route back into EU membership would be through an independent Scotland, because unfortunately, all of the UK parties have abandoned their commitment to return to the EU. And that's something of deep regret.
Question number five, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government, in light of any engagement that it has had with the UK Government regarding potential Barnett consequential funding, how much it anticipates that it will be able to allocate in its budget to address any risks arising from reinforced autoclaved aerated concrete?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, sir, I welcome very much the improved engagement with the new UK Government, although I've also repeatedly made clear that they need to invest in public services and infrastructure, which would generate consequential funding for the Scottish Budget. And we are, of course, assessing the implications of today's announcement by the Chancellor for the Scottish Budget, due to be presented to Parliament on the 4th of December.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response. RAT continues to impact over 100 homeowners in my constituency who are required to sell their homes by agreement with Aberdeen City Council or through the use of compulsory purchase. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if she agrees with me that in the event no Barnett consequential funding is forthcoming, a timely funding solution that enables the Council to purchase homes at a fair and equitable price, avoiding the use of compulsory purchase, should be sought as a matter of priority?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I said earlier, we need to work through the details of the budget announcement today, but I do recognise that this is a very difficult time for affected households. Aberdeen City Council is currently engaging with homeowners around voluntary sales based on market value. In addition, the Council has offered owners home loss payments of up to £15,000, disturbance payments and support with legal costs alongside rehoming support. And while the specific details of the offers are for Aberdeen City Council to determine, the Council has stated that the use of compulsory purchase powers would be a matter of last resort. Officials continue to engage with Council officers around this issue and will keep in close touch with them throughout this process to ensure that we understand the options available to the local authority.
And supplementary, Liam Kerr, who is joining us remotely. Mr Kerr.
This is a really important question.
Sorry, I beg your pardon. Mr Kerr is absolutely 100% with us. Please continue.
I am here, and I'm here to deliver what is a really important question, because we need to be clear. Aberdeen Council is offering these RAC-impacted homeowners market value of their properties plus a home loss payment, but minus the cost of repairing the RAC roof panels. Now, the residents have abandoned the process because it's unfair that they're subject to a RAC penalty, which will leave many in negative equity. Given this is ultimately about the underfunding of Aberdeen Council by this government, does the government intend to proactively get involved, or is it going to sit this one out?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, I don't accept the point about the underfunding of Aberdeen City Council, and I refer Liam Kerr to the comments I made earlier about the £14 billion, the comments of the Accounts Commission and Spice in this Parliament, which I know members like to quote, saying real terms increase for local government. However, I do recognise the issue that Liam Kerr has raised around the issue of negative equity, the issue of the cost of repair. And I would certainly be willing to have a follow-up conversation. And I would also want to look at RAC generally. Perhaps that's something we can talk about as part of the budget process going forward.
Question number six, Ben McPherson.
To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Finance Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues, City of Edinburgh Council and other relevant stakeholders regarding how its financial planning can support the delivery of affordable housing in Edinburgh.
Minister Ivan McKee.
The Cabinet Secretary for Finance and Local Government meets regularly with ministerial colleagues and with partners and stakeholders to discuss financial planning matters concerning Edinburgh and indeed elsewhere in Scotland. Those meetings cover housing along with other capital investment programmes.
Ben McPherson.
I thank the Minister for that answer, the Cabinet Secretary for that engagement and the collaborative work that Scottish ministers are doing across the board to support Edinburgh in its housing challenges. With a growing population and economy, demand for housing in Edinburgh is particularly acute. As ministers are aware, land in Granton in my constituency has the potential to meet a significant amount of this demand through the Granton waterfront development. Therefore, I would be grateful if the minister and officials could continue constructive dialogue with City of Edinburgh Council and others about coming to a financial arrangement sooner rather than later to realise more of Granton's potential for the benefit of the people of North Edinburgh and beyond, because it could be transformational.
Minister.
The housing-led regeneration and investment plans for Granton are ambitious and have the potential to deliver for local people and the regional economy, transforming lives, creating a strong sense of place and delivering jobs and prosperity. Officials are continuing to work with the City of Edinburgh Council and other key partners to explore options for how we might be able to progress the development.
Question number seven, Liz Smith.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has carried out regarding the potential impact of introducing a public health supplement to be paid by retailers in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government has engaged with relevant stakeholders, including public health organisations and retailers, to explore the potential effects the reintroduction of a public health supplement may have. This will ensure considered and informed decisions can be made in the context of the Scottish Budget for 25-26.
Liz Smith.
Thank you. In the SNP's New Deal for Business, ministers promised meaningful communication, evidence-based decision-making, and I quote, no surprises to the business community. So why is it nearly a year on that retailers are saying that they have been left in the dark when it comes to the possibility of this surtax? No cost-benefit analysis and no business and regulatory impact assessment. Because, Cabinet Secretary, if that was to go ahead, does she recognise that it would be the highest business rates in the UK, with the resulting burdens that that places on both costs and on shop prices?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, there has been engagement with the Scottish Government and retailers. A number of retailers have reported how a public health supplement could impact their business, which of course is being considered as part of the exploration of this policy. And as part of the commitment to the New Deal for Business, which Liz Smith referred to, we are committed to engaging with relevant stakeholders, including retail businesses, to ensure that any impact of any proposals on business is fully understood. And ministers have discussed the reintroduction of a non-domestic rates public health supplement in meetings with stakeholders and in other forums, and that will continue to be the case.
And question number 8, Alec Riley.
The presiding officer, to ask the Scottish Government what discussions it's having with COSLA regarding the 2025-2026 local government finance settlement.
Cabinet Secretary.
As is the case in advance of every budget, we are having regular and routine engagements with COSLA and individual local authorities as we shape our proposals for 2025-26.
Alec Riley.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. She must be aware of the massive cuts that are taking place in communities up and down Scotland. Libraries are being proposed to shut in Perth and Kinross, swimming pools, community centres, community facilities, youth services devastated, housing lists grown. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that unless the government gives a larger share of the cake to local councils, then public services at a community level are going to be completely devastated?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say, first of all, to Alex Riley, as I said in my earlier answer, we are actually giving a larger share of the cake of discretionary spend. It's gone up by about 1%. However, let me acknowledge the point that Alec Riley is making. There's pressure on public services, without a doubt there is, and local authorities are no different in that case. We can't have more than 10 years of austerity and for that not to be the case. And I'm more than happy to discuss with Alec Riley as we enter the budget process what his views and ideas are in terms of local government. And if he wants to meet with me to discuss that, I would be more than happy to do so.
Brief supplementary, Katie Clark.
Does the Cabinet Secretary expect that the 2025-26 settlement will reverse a decade of cuts and stop cuts such as in North Ayrshire, where the local authority is proposing removing 90 teaching jobs, a charge of £50 for a food waste collection, and reducing other bin collections from 3 weekly to 4 weekly?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, look, as I said, there is pressure on all public services. Local government does have an increased share of the overall discretionary spend, but I do recognise pressure on services, and we will look at that along with all of the other priorities for the budget in terms of 25-26. We are having regular dialogue with COSLA and indeed individual local authorities where many of these points are made, and I'm more than happy to discuss that with others across this parliament. So if the member wants to meet with me, I extend the same offer to her.
Brief supplementary, Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Given the significant implications for the Scottish Budget and the Scottish Government's ability to provide a suitable settlement for local government, can I ask for an initial reaction to the UK Budget in relation to local government?
Cabinet Secretary.
So we are working through the detail of the budget, and of course I would want to recognise it is very much a step in the right direction, particularly in relation to the capital availability for 25-26. We need to work through the detail and things like, for example, the impact of NI employer contributions to the public purse. That will be one factor that we need to look at. But of course, you can't address over a decade of austerity in one budget. So we need to see that investment continue in order to repair the damage of years of austerity. And of course, the removal of £15 billion of resources into public services since 2021. That will take more than one budget to address, but we're very pleased that our calls for investment in public services have been heeded, and it is, as I said, a step in the right direction.
And brief supplementary, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Councillors cannot expect to deal with their implementation of when they continually have squeezed the breaking point, while the cost of delivering statutory duties such as social care keep rising. So what steps is the Scottish Government taking to ensure that the forthcoming local government finance statement provides the real-term increase in discretionary spending powers that local authorities require, Cabinet Secretary?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I said earlier, we will look at this and we will talk to COSLA and local authorities and indeed any members across this chamber about the local government settlement. But again, I think Alexander Stewart has not got the memo from his leader, Russell Finlay, who has been clear that public services and the spending on them needs to reduce in order to fund a reduction in taxes. So you can't have increased funding on local government or anywhere else and reduce taxes at the same time. It's just not credible or economically literate. So we'll continue to discuss these matters. I'm more than happy to meet with anyone across this chamber who wants to talk about the funding of local government as part of the budget discussions going forward.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on finance and local government. There'll be a very short pause before we move on to the next line of business. Thank you.